everybody. Welcome back for another ISSA Talk. I am your host, Jenny Scott, Senior Product Developer or Content Developer here at ISSA, Certified Personal Trainer, Sports Conditioning Specialist. I am here with an amazing guest, and actually, full disclosure, you guys, I actually know our guest today. He's actually married to one of my best friends since high school. I have an Olympic medalist with us, Matt Antoine. Hello, Matt.
Hello, how are you doing?
I'm good. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Absolutely. I mean, we're recording this right now in the midst of the Winter Olympics, which is totally your jam, and everybody will find out why here very, very soon. But so much tradition goes into the Olympics, like since way back when, since we all can remember. A lot of us look forward to the Olympics. I know you did for the longest time. But we want to know more about you, and let's talk about some, let's get real about some of the things that are going on out there with high-level athletes, and you having been one, like, and being one, you know, I mean, it's not something you just stop doing, right? We would love to hear your insight on some things. So, Matt, you are a two-time Olympian. How did this happen? Tell us about you.
Well, I got into the sport of skeleton, which I know is probably a very lesser known sport. It's not one of these sports that finds you. You kind of have to go find it. And so how I got involved was during the 2002 Olympics. Skeleton had made its return as a full-time Olympic sport. It caught my attention. The U.S. did really, really well, had a lot of press around it. And so I just decided I was going to go figure out how I can try out for this weird sport. And so I started emailing a bunch of random people and found out I had to go to Lake Placid, New York. Now, I grew up in Wisconsin, so wasn't really anywhere near a track. And I got into a tryout in Lake Placid, made a trip out there, you know, convinced my mom that she should take me out there to try out for this sport. And that was really kind of the start of how I got into it. Now, it didn't go real well at the beginning. I actually got kicked out after my first week, and I had to go try out again the next season. But that was really the beginning of skeleton, kind of worked my way into the development program and then worked it up through there.
That's cool. Okay, so two questions with that. What were you playing sports before you started skeleton?
Yeah, so I'd kind of always been a person that was interested in a lot of sports, kind of got my hand in a little bit of everything, but I would say there was nothing I really overly excelled at. I did enjoy track, and track is kind of a natural transition into skeleton because being able to push the sled, being fast at the start is really important for the sport. And so I would say that was probably one of the things I did growing up that had the easiest transition into the sport. But I always loved anything that went fast. I always loved speed. You got to be a little bit of a daredevil. So, you know, kind of some of the winter sports have a lot of that flavor to it. And so growing up snowboarding too, I guess I kind of got a little bit of that, the taste of that. And that helped make me make the transition into skeleton as well.
That's awesome. Okay, so you kind of led me to my second question. Explain to somebody who's never seen skeleton before, what exactly is it and what skills are required to do this sport?
Right. So usually when I tell people I've done skeleton, you know, I'm always like, do you know what that is? That's always my first question to them. Most of the time they say no. So then I ask, well, do you know what bobsled is? And people have seen the movie Cool Runnings or whatnot. So most people know what bobsled is. And so then I say, okay, it's like bobsled. It's a sliding sport. It's on the same track, except this is an individual sled that is headfirst on your stomach up to 90 miles an hour.
Yes. All right. So yes, you jump on the sled and you're just cruising.
Yes, absolutely. No fear. There's no brakes. So, you know, once you're going, you're committed.
Oh my God. Well, how do you stop at the end?
Well, the bottom of the track goes uphill and then you just kind of naturally slow down after that. So.
Oh, yeah. Matt, I didn't know you were a daredevil. Goodness.
Yeah. Once you go, you're going.
Oh my gosh. And like I said, we're in the middle of the Winter Olympics right now. One of my favorite things that I saw recently online was all the skeleton helmets, because they're facing their head first. So they have some pretty cool helmets. Have you seen any that you liked, or did you have any cool ones?
You know, I had a pretty boring helmet myself. That kind of started towards the second half of my career, people trying to make interesting helmets, because it is kind of a prominent piece when we're going down the track, you know, the head's the first thing you see. And so people started to capitalize on that. For me personally, I think my helmet was always just like the base white that it came in. And then I had a black visor and that was it. People get really, really interesting, especially during the Olympics. They try to show some national pride. And so you kind of see a lot of people's flags or things about their country that are integrated into their helmet. So it is really, it's kind of cool and interesting to see what people come up with for the games.
Very nice. Yeah, I mean, the costumes and the outfits and stuff are always pretty elaborate for the Olympics anyway.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Very cool. So tell us about some of your favorite memories being an Olympic athlete, because you've been twice. Which ones did you go to?
Correct. I've been to two Olympic Games. So 2014 was my first Olympics in Sochi, Russia. And then 2018 was my last Olympics in Pyeongchang, South Korea. And there was a lot of buildup to that. You know, I'd been in the sport for 11 years prior to making my first Olympic team. And so, you know, I think when people watch the Olympics, they kind of see that one competition, but there's a lot that goes into the buildup of that. And, you know, over the years in the sport, you travel with a lot of the same people, you know, whether it be your teammates or people from other countries that you're competing against. So you do really build a lot of good, close relationships with your fellow competitors over the years. I mean, there are people that I traveled with for close to 15 years throughout the sport. And so I think that alone is probably some of my favorite memories of the sport and the Olympics. It's just kind of almost like growing up with these people and the memories you make. And yeah, there's a lot of boring downtimes in regards to the sport. So it's kind of the fun things you do outside of actual competition too. Those are definitely the memories I would carry with me the most. But you know, specifically at the Olympics, 2014, I won an Olympic medal. And so it's hard to say that wouldn't be towards the top of my list of memories through the sport.
That's very cool. Now, speaking of the things that you do in your downtime and making friends and everything, have you held on to a lot of the friends that you've made over the years?
I have. Yeah, I keep in contact with most of them. Most of the people that I competed with are retired at this point. And so we all kind of, especially right now during the Olympics, we watch the competitions and then we're all kind of texting of what we think of what, you know, happened, who we thought was going to win, who thought we would have done better, things like that. And so, yeah, we definitely still stay well connected.
That's so awesome. Lifelong friends. Very cool.
Absolutely.
Now, speaking of retirement, again, guys, I know him, so I'm kind of leading him a little with these questions. I actually don't know you that well, Matt. Like, I've hung out with you many times and stuff, and of course, you're married to my best friend. But so when you retired from the sport, I know you went into coaching. Tell me a little bit about that, and then let's talk, we'll dig a little deeper here. Tell me a little bit about coaching. What was that experience like for you?
Yeah, so after I stopped competing in 2018, personally, I didn't really know if I was ready to retire after those Olympics. I kind of took some time, thought about it. I actually went back to Lake Placid, took a few runs, and then decided that, yeah, I was done. My body was done. Mentally, I was done, everything like that. So, you know, my time competing as an athlete had passed, but I still loved the sport. And I also really didn't kind of have a plan for what I was going to do after I was done competing. And the program was really in the need of a coach, and being one of the more successful athletes that's come through the program, they immediately kind of started recruiting me, asking me, hey, do you want a job? Do you want a coach? And I was like, yeah, that sounds good. So I stepped right out of the athlete role, right into the coaching role, like almost instantaneously. And then I started working more with the development athletes because our program is going through a bit of a rebuilding structure right now. And so they're putting a lot of focus in towards bringing new people into the sport, introducing them, helping develop them. So that was kind of my main focus there for a while. And it was good. It reminds you of what it was like to start out. You know, after you've spent 15 years in the sport, you kind of forget what it was like on that first run down the track and how kind of scary it can be, the unknown, everything involved with it. And so it was interesting coaching those new athletes, kind of putting myself back in those shoes. Also realizing that, you know, my language of how I talk about the sport's pretty advanced for someone who's never done it before. And so I had to kind of take a step back and almost start simplifying everything that I was talking about again to people that don't know anything about the sport. And so it was a kind of a relearning process of the sport for myself as well.
Absolutely. Did it kind of, like, did you get the bug again? Did you want to race again?
I didn't want to race again, but I will say I was quite entertained watching people take their first runs down the track, remembering like how rough it can be. And so, you know, we hate to say as coaches that we enjoy watching that, but yeah, it's a little fun, you know, you right. kind of see people get down the bottom of the track and just like the wide eyes of like, you know, they just saw a ghost or something like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Now I'm a coach too for volleyball. And I know that coaching is very, very different than playing the sport. Just like you said, not only the terminology that you use, the way you have to explain it to someone, right? You have to break mm-hmm. things down to their fundamental points. But outside of the physical aspects of your sport, and I'm asking for you and for the athletes that you coached, what did you guys, it's really intense to train, not only at that Olympic level, but in general for a new sport, a different sport, right? It's not a common right. sport. Did you guys run into any like mental health concerns or anything like that?
Yeah, I think that's a common thing through all sports, and you know, skeleton was no exception. You know, when I started the sport in 2003, I think that's something that wasn't really talked about. And so to be honest, like those avenues weren't there to help people kind of develop the mental aspects needed for the sport. So really a lot of us just kind of, you worked through it on your own. You kind of went through the trials and tribulations, you know, the low points, the high points, but, you know, thankfully kind of focusing on the mental aspect is something that has developed more over the years. And for the development program that's in place for the US program now, there are aspects of that that are being built in, kind of helping people develop the mental skills needed to be successful too. But, you know, for me personally, I kind of had to work through it. And I definitely had some tough times that brought me into some low points that I kind of had to dig myself out of and find resources to work through that. Because, you know, a lot of sport is mental, especially when you get up to the Olympic level. Like everyone's good. Everyone is talented physically. Like they all know how to do the sport. Really what separates people when you get up to the Olympic level is who can mentally perform at that level. And that's where you see a lot of the separation from the good and the great athletes.
Absolutely. Did you find that like the mental, at least for you anyway, I mean, you can speak for yourself. Did you find that any the things that you were dealing with were more like competing with yourself, or like, was it in the competition with others where you were having issues?
For me, it was more internal. You know, you especially when you start to go through maybe some bad stretches of performances, you really start to doubt yourself and get down on yourself, and like you become your own worst enemy at times. And for me, that was kind of a main point that led me to some of my failures in the sport. So I say 2014 was my first time making the Olympics, but I was favored to make the Olympics in 2010. The year prior, I was the top U.S. skeleton athlete. I had won a World Cup medal at the test event for the Olympics. So it's like, not only was I thought of, you know, as someone who was going to make the 2010 team, I was thought of someone who was potentially going to medal at the 2010 Olympics. And mentally, I was not prepared for that kind of internal pressure. When the next season came around for the Olympics, I just, to put it bluntly, just crumbled. I didn't know how to handle the pressure. I did not perform well. I had a terrible, terrible season and ultimately did not make the Olympic team. And, you know, it wasn't physically because I didn't know how to slide anymore or anything like that. It's just mentally, I could not perform at all. And so I think that was really one of the biggest points in my career where I realized I needed to take a step back, kind of reassess, like, what happened? Like, why did this go wrong? And what do I need to do going forward to make sure it doesn't happen again? So that way, when 2014 came around, and, you know, I didn't have a repeat of that situation. So that's what caused me to seek out the opportunities that the U.S. Olympic Committee was offering in terms of sports psychology. And I really kind of had to spend that next summer in 2010 rebuilding my mental state within the sport so that I could perform well going forward.
That's awesome. So what kind of resources were they able to offer you guys with the USA team?
So they have a handful of sports psychologists, and, you know, I went through a few of them. You know, not all sports psychologists are the same, you know, and it is very much a personal relationship. And so you kind of have to find someone that you personally click with, that kind of gets you, can communicate well with you. And so I did go through a few, but I ended up finding one that I worked really, really well with. And he was good at kind of digging at the root of why, you know, I was having these thoughts of, you know, failure or just not believing in myself anymore and kind of working through them. And he was really good about helping me set, you know, shorter term goals so I could see potential progress. And so that way I wasn't so farsighted of like, I want to make the Olympic team. I want a medal. It's like, okay, but there's a lot that has to go from here to here to get to that point. And so he was really good at helping me set forth those goals so that way I could see the progress and then I could keep the belief going that I can get to that point.
That's really cool. And did you help the athletes that you were able to coach? Were you able to share some of that and impart some of that knowledge with them?
Yeah. And like I said, when I was talking about athletes getting involved, it is such a very new thing. You know, you kind of see, you know, the wide eyes and just it's such a new experience to them that when they take their first run, they're like, I don't get this. Like, how am I ever going to understand the sport? How am I going to progress in it and everything like that? And so kind of taking those lessons, you know, that I learned, you know, I'm trying to set forth really like small goals so that way they can see kind of like those mental breakthroughs, you know, whether it be day to day, week to week, so they can see some progress. So they're not just thinking like, I know nothing about this sport too, I want to make it to the Olympic team. You know, they've got to have the small incremental steps along the way. And so I think that's something that the program has done a good job at the development level of implementing. So that way it's not just kind of like, throw everyone into the fire and see who survives, you know, at this point, because that's kind of how it was before. So yeah, they are definitely taking some of those lessons and helping it to progress into more of a structured program.
Very cool. This is so funny to hear you talk about this, Matt, because I study sports psychology part two, and I actually work with my college volleyball team on that. But a lot of stuff makes sense for you when I hear you talking about this, because you guys don't know this about Matt, but Matt is a phenomenal woodworker. He loves to work with his hands, and he actually built like your kitchen table. Like, what are some other things that you built?
Kitchen table, various furniture around the house. We put in a fireplace, so I built the mantle and everything around it. We recently just redid the entire backyard, so I did that.
By we, you mean him. Your wife was taking
exactly.
Posting him online.
Yeah, I give my wife credit, but I'm doing the work, so, you know.
Yes. Yeah, so this makes sense for me. Like, you love detailed, intricate work. And guys, his work is beautiful. Absolutely gorgeous.
Thank you.
The point where all of us came over to your house at one point, like a year and a half ago, and we all were like, can we hire you? Can we, like, clients already, Matt.
Exactly.
So this makes sense for me. Like, everything's clicking. I love it. So speaking about all the psychology of sport and things, how did you feel when athletes like Simone Biles and Michael Phelps, some of these really high level, very popular athletes, were coming out with their struggles and things that they were going through, and they came out in like a very real way? How did that hit home for you?
No, I think it's great to see. I've seen, being in the realm, I've seen a lot of athletes kind of come out with those struggles over the years. I mean, I personally did too, but the thing is, you know, for myself and others, we're not high profile names. And so it doesn't really garner a lot of attention. And so it's nice when someone like, Simone Biles or Michael Phelps, people who have a lot of clout in the sports realm and are going to get a lot of media attention are willing to do that because, it can bring a lot of scrutiny upon them. And so, you know, there is a bit of a risk whether or not they should or shouldn't say anything. But it also brings a lot of awareness to the issues, and it helps, you know, grow the mindset around mental health and that it's okay to have struggles and be honest about it. And so it helps other athletes to then be more open about it. So I think it's really great that they have been willing to share that about themselves and, you know, hopefully help push that conversation further.
Absolutely. Yeah, I appreciated that a lot about them because it did take some guts to be able to step up after being on such a big pedestal, you know?
Absolutely.
And Mike, he says it. The one thing he always says, it's okay not to be okay, right?
Exactly.
And, you know, it's okay to have these issues and it's okay to struggle with them publicly and to seek help for them. Simone Biles, a lot of what you talked about earlier, the pressure that you feel when you're like, people expect so much from you. And then a lot of you guys, you're such good athletes. You're so like mentally stable that you internalize a lot of that pressure.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's easy to keep it boxed inside and just, you know, like, this isn't going to bother me. You kind of push it away, but when you do that too often, it builds and builds and builds, and then it can eventually kind of blow up at the wrong time. So it's good to be honest about it and, you know, acknowledge that it's there.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And then seek resources that can help you manage it.
Absolutely.
Very cool. All right. So any athlete, whether they're just starting like maybe a high school sport or just getting into a sport or going for that elite level, what's one piece of advice that you'd give to any athlete of any age with aspirations of competing at a high level?
Patience. I think it's patience across all sports. You know, you're not going to walk into something that you maybe haven't done much or, you know, aren't too experienced at and just be successful right away. And I think, you know, a lot of people want that success immediately. Like, I just want to be good at it. Well, it takes a lot of work to get there, you know, and like I said, you have to set those small goals along the way so that you can see that progress towards that bigger goal. But it's definitely a patience game. You have to be willing to put in the work when no one's looking. Really, you know, put in the effort over the years. You have to make a lot of sacrifices involved with it, you know, whether it be friends, family, social engagements, things like that. Like, you have to be willing to put in the time over the years to get to the point to where you want to be. And so you have to have that patience.
Absolutely. And I know, especially for someone like you in a sport that you do, where you had to go to a very specific part of the country for, like, we all live in Arizona right now. They don't have skeleton trails or tracks here. Right. And I remember when I first met you before you married Sheila, there was a lot of time that you were gone for at least half the year. Right.
Yeah. So yeah.
It was a big sacrifice.
Yeah, absolutely. I think anyone that I've talked to in any sport that's been successful, you know, whether it be not only them, but sometimes their family too, like, you have to make those sacrifices, willing to go places, willing to give up a lot of things. You know, if this is your ultimate goal, you really have to commit to it 100%.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, you have a phenomenal wife, if I do say so myself. I've known her for 23 years now. And she was always so supportive of you. And like, when you would travel, she's like, oh, he'll be back, you know?
Yeah.
That you were doing what you love to do. Very cool. Yeah. So now that you've retired from coaching, what are you up to now?
Well, you know, you mentioned my woodworking skills and desires, and, you know, also not just fine woodworking, but obviously working on homes, renovations, everything like that. I've always had an interest in that over the years. And when I moved to Phoenix in 2015, you know, I bought a house and I renovated the entire thing myself, and now working on the home that Sheila and I live in, kind of working a lot of projects here. So I've taken that knowledge and kind of that joy of those projects and turned that into a career. So now I have my Arizona home inspector's license, and I started my own home inspection business, and now I'm working towards building that. Kind of it's different than sport, but at the same time, you know, trying to build something from nothing, really. You know, I set forth this goal that this is what I wanted to be, and I wanted to build this business. And so kind of taking a lot of those similar lessons and, you know, things I've experienced over the years of sport, and now trying to apply it towards a new career. And so I'm enjoying the process of not only becoming a home inspector, but building out the business and hopefully turning it into a successful one.
Yes, the lesson of patience is true when you're building a business, right?
Exactly. Yeah, you question yourself a lot at the beginning. You're like, is this a good idea? But, you know, you get those small victories along the way, and that's what keeps you going.
Absolutely. I love it. Well, and also you have a new puppy at home that you can work with, right?
Yes. Yeah, and a lot of patience with the puppy as well. So.
Yeah. What? Tatum is a golden retriever, right?
Golden retriever, yeah. She's 10 months old right now. Tons of energy. Loves everybody. You know, just wants to jump on everything. Yeah, run around. So she keeps us entertained for sure.
Nice. I feel like Tatum should have her own like Instagram profile and post videos and stuff. Just saying. If you decide to do it, we'll post it here so everybody can follow her.
All right. I'll run it by her and see what she thinks.
Right. She'll love it.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much for speaking so candidly with us, Matt, and for sharing your story.
Yeah, no, I appreciate the opportunity. It's always fun to share in my experiences, and, you know, hopefully people take interest in it and can also learn a thing or two from it as well. So I appreciate the opportunity to share it.
We love it. So before we go though, one last question. So again, we're in the middle of the Winter Olympics as we're filming this. What, besides for skeleton, what is your favorite sport from the Winter Olympics to watch?
You know, I've always enjoyed short track. Yeah, I've always enjoyed short track speed skating. And I think because if anyone that's watched it, it's a bit of a crazy wild sport. There's crashes, weird things happen. It's a very unpredictable sport. And so that's why I think I'm kind of entertained by that sport. You never really know what's going to happen. So it's kind of like organized chaos, as I like to say. And so that's why I think I'm really, really entertained by that sport.
Nice. That's the one that Apollo Ono used to compete
right.
in.
Right. Yep. Yep.
Nice. I do remember that name. Very cool. Well, thank you again for being here with us, Matt. Thank you guys all for joining us. Hopefully you got something out of this. And we will be talking to you soon. Thanks for joining.